Basically, you are just having a really bad day and you end up cursing somebody out. You call them a rude name under your breath, you say something mean, and then hopefully you just walked away and nothing happened, right? But now, imagine this, if you will. It is the 17th century. You are down on your luck. Your family is poor and you have nothing to your name. And you ask a peddler for a handout and they refuse to help you. They turn you away and they say, get lost. And this is probably like the 10th, maybe 20th person that has talked to you like that day. And you've had enough. You are at your wit's end and you curse this guy out. And immediately after cursing this guy out, he becomes confused, dizzy. One side of his body goes numb and he drops to the ground because his body has given out. And the year is 1612. So can you guess what likely happens? Yeah, you are now accused of nearly killing somebody through witchcraft. So this very simple exchange of words between a beggar and a peddler on March 18th, 1612 would begin what is the largest, most infamous, and best documented witch trial in England's history, where 12 innocent people were accused of witchcraft and 10 of them were found guilty and sentenced to die. And everything in this trial was, of course, based on completely made up witness testimony, and it set a terrifying precedent for future witch trials around the world. So, without further ado, my friends, tonight I'm going to be telling you all about the Pendle witch trials. So good. The Pendle witch trials have to start with King James the First, and I have to go into the history here just to give you a better understanding of today's story. You can skip ahead if you like, of course, but I wouldn't recommend it. So King James the First, he was King of Scotland from July 24th, 1567, and then he became King of England and Ireland on March 24th, 1603, until his death in 1625. King James was raised to be a very devoted Protestant. So after the Scottish Reformation in 1560, the Catholic Church was outlawed, and it was part of the wider European Protestant Reformation that took place, meaning the government wanted everybody to be Protestant. And what happened was that King James's mother, Mary Queen of Scots, she was a very devoted Catholic. And so in order to stop her religious influence over her son, the Presbyterian ministers of the Church of Scotland, who basically raised James, they influenced him from a very young age to be an extremely devout Protestant. And like, they literally brainwashed him, I would say, into thinking that he was surrounded by the devil, by religious persecutions of Catholics, and obviously the horrible, horrible deaths of innocent people. And in regards to the Pendle Witch trials, what happened was that this dislike for Catholics got intertwined in this messy, very messy ball of religion, politics, fear, as well as witchcraft, and it pretty much gave the government another avenue to persecute Catholics, and it really was part of the catalyst for what started the Pendle Witch Trials. And just one more little nugget here, King James I was a believer in what was called the divine right of kings. Sounds fancy, but it was not. It meant that he believed that his authority came from God, directly from God, and therefore he could not be held accountable by any earthly authority like Parliament. So it basically just gave him the right to hunt innocent people down in literal witch hunts and execute them, because he was allowed to do it. Sounds like a real winner to me. I have always been a believer in this, but I'll say it again. We humans really are the scariest thing on this planet. There's obviously so much more to the history of this. I could go on for days and days, but I'm not going to, because I want to get into the witch part. But there is one more important fact that I need to educate you on. If you are from the UK, or just Europe in general, I'm sure you know all about this, but I personally never learned about it in school. It leads us to England on November 5th, 1605, to what was called the Gunpowder Plot. Here, super interesting, here a group of people actually attempted to assassinate King James and the Parliament by blowing up the Parliament building in London. So with barrels of gunpowder, the collaborators planned to blow up the building on the state opening day, when they knew that King James, lords, and all of the commons would be gathered and present in one place, right? And they were doing this, of course, in an attempt to end the persecution of Roman Catholics. people in Pendle, an area in Lancashire, they still clung to their Roman Catholic beliefs. So not only is it interesting, but it is important to the story to take note of the fact that people in this area, especially Pendle, were very strong in their beliefs. And in doing so, King James was afraid of them. And it's talked about how it's understandable, I guess, how he was afraid of Catholics. Like, Catholics had tried to murder him. They had tried to take him out. So he viewed them, especially the ones, like, hiding in Lancashire, he viewed them as dangerous people who were very likely going to make another assassination attempt on him, just like they did during the gunpowder plot. I believe they also tried to sink his boat when he was coming home from his honeymoon. I think they tried to take him out then as well, but that's for another day.
Through witchcraft.
Me because I didn't give her the oats. Yeah, what a lipstick. I don't know, it's probably more appropriate. They hate each other, and they're gonna take one another down. Just remember that. Alright. So, on March 18th, 1612, old Demdike's granddaughter Alizon, who again is Janet's older sister, is walking to Drawden Forest in Pendle. She passes by a peddler named John Law, and this guy is selling pins. He's like a merchant. Now, pins at this time in history were considered essential items. Like, people needed them for sewing and making clothing. They were just really important household items, but they were also used by witches. They were used for magical stuff like healing, treating warts, love spells, divination. They were used for a lot of stuff, and they were also very expensive. And it's not known if Alizon was begging John Law for some free pins, or if she said that she wanted to buy some. Regardless, the peddler refused to open his pack, and he called Alizon a thief and told her to get out of his way. And like I said at the beginning, this angered Alizon to the point that she cursed him. And I bet you anything, it was like the modern day equivalent of road rage or something, right? Like, she was just sick and tired of being walked over. And it was like road rage. She got angry. She said something angry. Yeah, she cursed him out of anger and frustration. And immediately after, the worst possible coincidence on earth occurred. John Law, the peddler, he falls to the ground. He is unable to move because one side of his body is paralyzed and he can't speak. Now, to us, like, he has clearly had a stroke, right? Everything was a clear sign of a stroke. But to people in the 17th century, especially in an area with dangerous people who made deals with the devil, John Law had clearly been the victim of a witch. Now, John Law survived. Oh my god, the witches are coming for me. Guys, I'm sorry, it's very stormy here. It's very windy, very rainy. But with the amount of trouble I have been having with recording this video, this is it. shockingly, again, even when she goes to visit him, John Law doesn't say anything. And I don't know, I guess it's maybe he still doesn't remember. The guy just suffered a stroke in the 1600s. I don't know, but yeah, maybe she could have gotten away. I'm not sure.
Discussion with John Law, and it
like taking this opportunity to throw other witches under the bus. I don't know, you might have done the same, I might have done the same in order to try and save ourselves. That sounds really, really bad, but again, this was 400 plus years ago. You don't know what you would have done. I give up trying to be graceful when I drink on camera. In addition, she tells Roger Knoll that old Chaddix and her daughter had also been making clay figures, which meant voodoo dolls. And she tells him all about the oatmeal deal as well, and how old Chaddix had killed her father, and in addition to other stuff, I believe she just spills the tea about everything. So things are getting really serious, and Roger Knoll now has all this information about multiple, like, working witches in Pendle, and how they are actually going around and killing people. And as dumb as I think most of this stuff is, jokes aside, like I was kind of getting at a minute ago, you have to think about this in terms of the fact that this was 400 plus years ago. These accusations of murder by witchcraft were as real to them as, like, I am sitting here right now. Like, attempted murder by witchcraft was as serious of an offense as attempted murder with a weapon. So, yeah, as dumb as I think it is, you have to think of it in terms like that. Anyway, with all of this information that Knoll is now gathering, it is not looking good for either the Southern family or the Chaddix family. And on April 2nd, 1612, old Demdike, so Alizon's grandmother, as well as old Chaddix and her daughter Anne Redfern, are all summoned to appear before Roger Knoll. And if you're wondering why he wanted to talk to Alizon's grandmother, it's because Alizon, in her confession, also talked about how her own grandmother was a witch. So she basically threw her own grandmother under the bus as well, but I'll get back to that. Knoll is now doing a full-fledged investigation and interviewing / interrogating everybody who has been mentioned by name. And remember, the old women, Chaddix and Demdike, they are both in their 80s. They are both apparently blind. And this part blew my mind, but I think maybe I understand what was going on. Both of them give these insane confessions about themselves to Roger Knoll, and I have a feeling that because they were so old, maybe they were trying to protect their families, and that was why they gave this crazy information to him. But I don't know, let me know what you think. These detailed confessions by the old women, this is why I have so much information on them. They came from a book called A Discovery of Witches, and this book was written by a guy named Thomas Potts. Potts was the court clerk during the Pendle Witch trials, so he literally wrote down, not word for word, but extremely detailed summaries of everything that was said in the courtroom during the trials. And he she was walking home and begging when she came to the gold shea stone pit in the Pendle Forest, and it was here where she met with the devil. She described it as a spirit or devil in the shape of a boy. The one half of his coat was black and the other was brown. He asked Elizabeth to stay with him, and if she would give him her soul, she should have anything that she would request. All it takes is your soul. It's no big deal. Elizabeth asked the spirit for his name, and he said that his name was Tib. T-I-P-B. She then agreed to give him her soul. The spirit appeared to Elizabeth for the next 6 years, and every time he would ask her, "What do you want me to do? Like, here I am at your command," and she would always say nothing, like there was nothing that she needed him to do. But then, when old Demdike's daughter, Elizabeth Davis, was born, the spirit changed form, and it changed into the likeness of a brown dog named Ball. Elizabeth then confessed to an altercation that occurred the previous year, so in 1611, and she said that her daughter Elizabeth Davis and her granddaughter Alizon Device, they had been helping a neighbor named Richard Folks at his mill, so they were just doing some odd jobs for extra money. And then when Elizabeth and Alizon went to Richard's house to go and collect their payment, he called them and witches, and he told them to get off of his property. He said, quote, "Get out of my grounds, and witches. I will burn the one of you and hang the other." And from my understanding, Elizabeth, old Demdike, she cursed him for talking to her daughter and her granddaughter like this. And she said, quote, "I care not for thee, hang thyself." And then she said her spirit or devil, Tib, reappeared and said, "Revenge thee of him." To which Elizabeth replied with, "Revenge thee either of him or his," meaning him or his family members. The spirit then vanished, and Elizabeth said, "I never saw him after this." And sometime after this encounter, Richard's daughter falls sick and dies. And later, in another of Alizon's confessions, she says, "Yeah, it was my grandmother. She cursed Richard and his family, and his daughter was bewitched and died because of her." Which is just crazy. I don't know. It's crazy that she would just throw her grandmother under the bus like that. But as I said, this was a scary time to be alive, and none of us know what we would do. But I certainly would not have done that. Old Demdike also confessed to Roger Knoll that she knew that the speediest way to kill a man was by making a, quote, "picture of clay." So she said the fastest way to kill a guy through witchcraft is to make a voodoo doll, which is like such a, again, a crazy thing to admit to a police officer when witchcraft is illegal. responsible for bewitching a man named Richard Ashton to death. Alizon confesses that 2 years prior, she had gotten this small pail of milk through begging, and she immediately brings it home to show her grandmother. She tells Noel that she was in the house for no more than half an hour, and during that time, she left the pail of milk on the counter, and her grandmother was asleep in the bedroom. But somehow, within that half an hour, that pail of milk, something happened to it. Inside the pail of milk, a quarter pound of butter magically appeared. There was no churning, there was no person making it into butter. It just magically produced a quarter pound of butter. But the strange part was that the quantity of milk in the pail remained the same. So the butter appeared, but they still had the same volume of milk. And in 1610, why in God's name would you be complaining about a free quarter pound of butter? Witchcraft or not, I don't care how it appeared. It is 1610 and you just got a free pail of milk and a free quarter pound of butter. It is 2023. I want free butter because it is so expensive. Actually, tell me in the comments, what country are you from and how much does butter cost for you right now? Because a normal brick of butter for me, not the expensive kind, just regular butter, is $9. $9. Nine frickin' dollars. And making it myself right now wouldn't be that much cheaper. It's insane. And I'd love to know how much butter is for you guys. But anyway, this doesn't really seem like a problem to me for this family. I don't understand why she is confessing this stuff to this police officer. It's weird. So weird. I don't get it. And then, of course, Alizon goes on to confess that she believed that it was her grandmother who had bewitched Richard Baldwin's daughter, the guy who had called the Devis women witches and said that he would hang them. So yeah, basically, old Demdike, old Sister. She was doing and how the game inclination to execute mischief takes great pains to apprehend such as were at liberty and prepared evidence against all such as were in question for witches. My stomach was growling quite loudly during that. I'm sorry. So yeah, Roger Noel completely believes that the party at Mocking Tower on Good Friday was just a meetup of witches, and they got together to form a plan to blow up Lancaster Castle and murder a jailer with magic. Makes sense, right? Because that is what most people do on Good Friday. I'm just gonna sit like this for a minute because my back hurts. But as I was saying, Noel went from 0 to 10 real quick, and I don't know if it was just because he was so zealous when it came to pursuing and persecuting witches, or if it was a combination of what Janet had told him, or maybe other people were like whispering stuff in his ear about this coven meeting at the Devis household. I think it was just him and what he believed. But anyway, whatever happened, every person at the Devis household that day who attended that party was arrested. They were arrested on suspicions of witchcraft. So, I don't know, like, just imagine going to your neighbor's house in support of the fact that their 80-year-old mother who is blind, in addition to other family members, have just been arrested, and they are sitting in a dirty, cold, scary dungeon, and you only go there to show your support, and now you're arrested because you are accused of being a witch just for associating with them. What a terrifying, terrifying time to be alive. I make that noise every time I take a sip. So, as I think I've mentioned many times now, the Devis family took every single chance that they could get to throw people under the bus. Because as Elizabeth is being arrested from her party, from her house, she is literally yelling out names of every other person who had been at her house that day. Even though they were no longer there, she's just calling out the names. They were here, they were here, they were here. You better go and arrest them as well. And I guess, I don't know, I guess her thought process was just, if I am going down for witchcraft, you are going down for witchcraft as well. I'm not going down alone. And again, I don't think I would have done that in the 1600s. But maybe I would have. I don't know. I don't think I would have. But I bet everyone says that no one knows what we would have done in this situation. The only person who was in attendance at the party that day who was not arrested was little 9-year-old Janet. She was not arrested, and this part of the story is so crazy, but also so sad, because it is this little girl, Janet Devis, who will be the undoing of her entire family. She is going to become the key witness for the trial, and the main reason why her entire family is about to be executed for witchcraft. A little 9-year-old girl. Now, you mark, and it was say, and if she did, I do not believe that she would have understood the consequences of what she was about to say. Like, I don't think she knew that her family was going to be executed if she called them out as witches. Or maybe she did. Maybe she did, I don't know. Or maybe she was just going along with what the police were telling her was the right thing to say. I have no idea. Jenna is like afraid or intimidated to talk while her mother is screaming at her like this. So she asks the court to remove her mom before she'll talk. They remove her back to the dungeons, and then Janet jumps up onto a table and she announces to the courtroom that her mother is a witch. She says, quote, "My mother is a witch, and that I know to be true. I have seen her spirit in the likeness of a brown dog, which she calls Ball. The dog did ask what she would have him do, and she answered that she would have him help her to kill John Robinson, James Robinson, and Henry Mitten." Janet then went on to tell the court all about the meeting at her house that day on Good Friday, but the party. And she said that her mother told her that everybody there in attendance was a witch. And then little Janet went out and she picked out from a lineup of people all of the people who had attended the party that day. And interestingly, the judges tried to see if they could catch her in a lie, just to see. And one of the judges made up a fake female name and he said, "Janet, did you see so and so at the party as well?" It was a fake name. And Janet was truthful. She said, "No, sir, I don't know that person, or I've never heard of that person." So unfortunately, that only gave her statements like more credibility. Yeah. Okay, we need a counter on that annoying noise I make. Janet's brother, James, even he testified against his own mother, and he told the court that he had seen Elizabeth Davis making clay dolls of one of these murder victims. He also told the court that his mother had stolen 3 human skulls and 4 human teeth from a gravesite in Pendle, and she had buried these in their front yard. And then these 4 teeth were actually presented as evidence along with one of the clay dolls that were found in the house. It's just so sad because it's a child, but it's just, all of it is devastating and disturbing, but without really knowing how to say it. James's testimony didn't help him in any way because Janet turned right around and testified against her brother, condemning him as a witch as well, telling the court that he had been practicing witchcraft She was charged with killing three men by witchcraft, one of them being Henry Mitten. And the reason was because he had refused to give her a penny. Yeah. Elizabeth Davis was charged with the murders of James Robinson, John Robinson, and together with Alice Nutter and Demdike, the murder of Henry Mitten. Alice Nutter, who again was really set apart from the rest of the accused because she was a wealthy landowner, she was also found guilty of witchcraft for simply being present at Mocking Tower that day during the party, and it's actually believed that she likely wasn't even there. She was probably just spotted nearby or on her way to another house by Janet. Catherine Hewitt, who had attended the meeting as well, she was found guilty of the murder of a woman named witch trials. videos, it would mean the world, and it really does help me as a creator so much, and it's just very appreciated.